pray briefly. Father, we thank you for leading and directing all that's said and done. Father, we know that you lead by your Spirit, and as many as receive you, you have given them the authority to become the sons of God. And we thank you, Father, for giving us wisdom and the ability to speak that which you shall direct us from our spirits. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. I want to talk about something this morning. I'm still speaking about the basic things, the end time. We were speaking about the judgment seat of Christ, and we want to focus a little bit more on the experience that believers will have just before the judgment seat of Christ takes place. In fact, this is going to be the experience that will snatch you away and bring you to God's presence. We call that the holy city. And this is going to be the scene where the judgment seat will be carried out. But it's going to take what I'm talking about today to get you before the judgment seat of Christ. It's going to take what God is going to do through what we are calling the rapture today. I just want to make some points on it. I'm not just teaching fully on that, but I wanted to bring some things to your attention so that you can understand the importance of the rapture and the importance of being ready for that particular event when it takes place. Now, I want to stress the imminency of the rapture. And see, without understanding the imminency of the rapture, that it could take place at any time, at any point, then that if you don't consider that as being imminent or something that could happen at any point, more than likely you're not going to be prepared when this event takes place. So you want to understand that the rapture is an imminent event. Now, if you go back to history of the church, the early Christians, the early fathers, amen, you can count hundreds of them that were noted leaders during that era of Christianity. All of them considered Christ's coming even then as being imminent, as being an imminent event. And that's the way God has always, and the Word has always projected the rapture as an imminent event. Now, the reason why I'm focusing on that, because very little preparation is being done today for the coming of Christ for the saints. Very little preparation. And this is a mistake that believers are making today. They're not preparing for Christ's coming. It's business as usual. And it's very rare you find people that even believe that he's coming again. Because what happens is that for 1,000 years, 400 AD up to 1500 AD, we passed through 1,000 years of dark ages, and it wasn't even taught, and the doctrine almost got lost, and it was revived somewhere in the 14th and 15th and 1600th century. And it's very important that we view this as something that's imminent. Now, what got my attention was when we were studying the book of Revelation, the first the third verse in the first chapter, that's the thing that really got my attention. It really began to dawn on me that the rapture could happen anytime. Yeah. See, there are 6,000 prophecies that point to the second coming of Christ. That means when Christ comes back with the saints, when he comes back to the earth, when he comes to judge the Antichrist and the nations, and when he comes to stop the bloodshed and to set up his millennial reign, that's when Christ is coming back with the saints and the mighty angels. And this is going to be a time that God is going to exercise judgment. Amen. It's going to be a judgment of the nations that's going to come before him. It's going to be the goat nations. It's going to be the sheep nations. The sheep nations are going to be the nations that received Christ during the 7 year of the tribulation period, when 144,000 flaming evangelists will go into the ends of the world preaching the gospel of the kingdom. It will be millions and millions and millions of people. In fact, when Joel prophesied about in the last day, God is going to pour out of his spirit upon all flesh, and it's going to be signs in the moon, signs in the sun, and the moon going to turn to blood and all of that. That is during the 7 year of tribulation period. The greatest revival in history will take place, and the greatest martyrdom, I mean, it will be the reign of the Antichrist, and many, many millions will give their life, amen, for the testimony of Jesus Christ. It's going to be a bloody time for believers. I mean, these are going to be the believers that will be saved during that 7 year period. Amen. But when Jesus comes back to the earth, there will be millions of people standing before him, amen, to be judged by him, amen. And then there are going to be millions and billions that we call the goat people, the goat nations, that's going to be turned into the lake of fire. They're going to be destroyed. They're going to be destroyed. So he's going to separate the sheep from the goats when he comes back to the earth. And this is the time right after the judgment of the nations. Amen. This is when he sets up his millennium reign. And all of those people that were saved, amen, that had the testimony of Jesus, that were living, of course, many of them are going to give their life. They're going to die for the sake of their testimony during that same 7 year period. Amen. But they will be resurrected, and they will receive their glorified bodies. But there will be natural people that will be here on the earth when Jesus comes. Some will go to eternal punishment, the goats on the left, but the sheep on the right. He says, come, enter the kingdom that was prepared for you before the foundation of the world. Amen. I'm not preaching on that. If I was preaching on that, I would read it to you. But it's in Matthew 25. I'm just trying to give you just a brief scenario of the events that I'm going to be describing today. Amen. But the point I want to make is that the different views that different people have. Some people say, well, I believe in the pre-trib rapture view. All right. Some say, well, I believe in the mid-trib rapture view. Some say, well, I believe that it's just going to be one time that Christ is going to appear. Amen. And everybody that's going to be saved or lost is just going to have to work with that one time, I guess. Okay, but see, that means that if you believe in the post-trib, that Jesus is going to come for us, or the saints, or those that's dead in Christ, at the end of the tribulation, that means that we, at that point, we will be what? Resurrected. And we will receive our glorified bodies, and everybody will go back to heaven with him. Okay, but that's not the view I hold. Amen. So if you believe in the post-trib, so all the saints will be caught up, right? Caught up. Some say, well, I don't know. Amen. I don't know which way to believe. All right. Now, if all the saints are caught up, and all the natural people that's living just stay in their places, and all of the evil nations, when Jesus comes, are going to have to be what? Judged. So Jesus is going to have to judge the evil nation and the what? Good nations, right? Alright, now, so how could all the saints in all the different ages just vanish and go back to heaven? And he only got two nations before him, the ones on the right and the left. Alright, and those live people, he said they're going to what? Go into the kingdom. So it wouldn't be anybody here present to rule and reign with Christ, because all you would have is just the people that will be going into the millennium kingdom, but the people on the left is going to go what, to their destruction, and everybody else is going to be caught up with Jesus, caught up in the air, and go to the New Jerusalem. So that theory just won't work. Amen. So it has to be, in order for anything to make sense, you have to almost be persuaded to believe that the rapture will take place just before the man of sin is revealed. That's just before the man of sin is to be revealed. That's before the seven mystery years, before the 7 year. And 7 years later, after we go and experience judgment, amen, we're going to be examined. That's the good part. That's what we've been talking about for the last several weeks. Amen. We're all going to stand before the judgment, what? Seat of Christ. Is that right? Amen. We read those scriptures over and over. It's my man back there. He got the scriptures back. Okay. 1 Peter 4:17-18. You want to write that down. Those are the scriptures that show you that the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. 1 Peter 4:17-18. 1 Peter 4:17-18. All right. 1 Peter 4:17-18 shows that the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first began at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? So the judgment for believers will be the first judgment, and this will take place at the beginning of the 7 year period that we call. See, there will be two judgments going on at the same time. It will be a judgment for the believers that's coming before the judgment seat of Christ. Amen. These are the people that will be raptured when Jesus comes for the saints in the air. Amen. See, Jesus is going to come back for the saints in the air. Amen. We're going to be caught up. This is what 1 Corinthians 15, amen, 51-54 teaches. That we'll be caught up. Paul said this was a mystery. That was the reason why. You can read all through the Bible, but you won't find only through Paul, who had the revelation. Amen. He had the revelation that Christ is going to come and snatch the saints away and take them back to heaven. Jesus even said this in St. John 14:3. He said, "Behold, I go away to prepare a what? Place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will receive you unto myself." So wherever I am, amen, there ye shall be. So he's going to snatch us away and take us back to be with him in what? In heaven. And that's the scene that we are trying to describe to you today. The time has come that the judgment must first begin at the house of God. The believer will be the first one that will be what? Judged. And we do know that the ungodly, you know, there's going to be a judgment when Christ comes back 7 years later to the earth. And there will be a separation of what? The sheep from the goat. That will be another judgment. Amen. But that's different from the what? Judgment seat of Christ. That's when Christ comes back to the earth. Amen. To set up his millennium rule, he's going to spend a certain period of that time, a certain number of days, separating the good nations from the what? Bad nations. That is actually going to take place. Amen. And the good nation are going to be what? Invited to come into the what? Everlasting kingdom. And there they will be with Christ for 1,000 years ago. And we the saints, who's going to come back with Christ, amen, to rule and reign on the earth, we're going to what? We're going to rule and reign with him for that 1,000-year period. How many can say amen?
Amen.
How many believe what I'm telling you?
Amen.
All right, so the point I want to make, let me just read the scripture to you as well. 2 Corinthians 5:10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. This is 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or what? Bad. Okay? So that's the second scripture that lets you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that believers, all believers, will appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and they will receive. Amen. They will be examined. The deeds that they perform, the works and the service that they perform on the behalf of Christ while they were in this life, these are going to be the issues. These are the things that God is going to what? Judge us as believers on. Our service.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. How many can say praise God?
Praise God.
Amen. Let me just diverse a little bit here. There's a scripture.